Hey, welcome back to another Learn Electronics for Beginners video. We'll be talking about all the little things in this video, things like atoms and electrons. We'll be talking about what electricity actually is at the atomic level. Okay, let's talk about things that matter. Matter is made of atoms, and no matter what it is, it consists of electrons, protons, and neutrons. We've talked a little bit about this before way back in my What is Current Direction video, but we're diving a little deeper this time around. So an atom is the smallest part of an element, and each atom on the periodic table of elements has a unique number of protons identified by the atomic number in the upper left side of its box. A stable atom is one in which there are an equal number of protons and electrons. In a normal atom, the positive charges of the protons and the negative charges of the electrons cancel each other out, so there is no net charge. In the What is Current Direction video, I talked about how if an atom contains one less electron or one extra electron, it will have a net negative or net positive charge. This is what we call an ion. It's just a fancy way of saying an atom has a net positive or net negative charge. When electric current flows, sometimes it's the electrons flowing as in a metal conductor, and sometimes it's the ions flowing as in the electrolyte of a lead-acid battery. Remember, current is just the movement of charge over a period of time, whatever form that charge might take. So these electrons that like to come and go as they please in a metal conductor we call free electrons, and it takes some energy to make them free. But we're getting a little ahead of ourselves. First, we need to talk about the shells. In the Bohr model of the atom, the protons and neutrons exist in the nucleus of the atom. That's the middle. And the electrons exist in specific shells or energy levels around the nucleus. We refer to these shells from the inside out as shell 1, shell 2, and so on. Now, each of these shells can only contain a certain amount of electrons, and they follow a pattern. N stands for the shell number, so if we're talking about the first shell, we insert 1 for the value for N. 1 to the power of 2 equals 1, and 1 times 2 equals 2, so our first shell can contain 2 electrons. Doing the math for our second shell, 2 to the power of 2 equals 4, times 2 equals 8, so our second shell can contain 8 electrons. Go ahead and pause the video for a second and do the math yourself to figure out how many the third shell can contain. That's right, 18. You're good at this. I knew you'd get it. Okay, knowing about the shells and how many electrons they can contain is important for understanding the electrical properties of the element we're dealing with. We call the outer shell our valence shell, and it contains our valence electrons because they're revalent. Bad joke. Okay, these outer shell valence electrons are party animals. They like to be in a crowd where the party's hopping. So when there aren't many electrons in the valence shell, they have a greater tendency to peace out and leave. However, when the outer shell starts to fill up and become more established, it's harder to get them to leave. Gotta call the police! This gives us some idea of which elements tend to be more conductive than others. Now, before we get too crazy here, there's more that goes into what makes something a good conductor of electricity or not. Most of us are generally aware that metals tend to be good conductors, and a lot of the reason behind this is due to the matrix formation of the atoms within metals. Other non-metallic materials may not be good conductors at all based on their molecular structure and the strength of their atomic bonds. Atomic bonds. But this isn't a chemistry channel. We like electrical stuff here, so we're aiming for a general basic understanding. Alright, to drive this point home, let's check out some elements on the periodic table. Think of something you know is useful for conducting electricity. Like copper. Most people know that copper is conductive. It's what's used for most wiring. So on the periodic table, it shows 29 as its atomic number. That's 29 protons in its nucleus. So a stable atom of copper will have 29 electrons in its shell. Let's go ahead and fill out our electron shells for a copper atom. The first shell has 2 electrons. The second has 8. The third has 18, which leaves just one sad, lonely electron in the outer valence shell. It definitely wants to peace out. So that's what makes copper a good conductor. Now that we've taken a look at copper and have an understanding of the valence shell, what other elements do you think would make a good conductor? Let me know in the comments. Here's a hint. Many computer components have gold plating on their connections. Gold is pretty expensive, so why do you think they chose it over something cheaper? Alright, in the next video we'll be talking a bit more about materials, specifically 3 categories of materials used in electronics. Conductors, semiconductors, and insulators. Be sure to subscribe so you don't miss it, and don't forget to smash that like button. This is Life Meet Lightning, bringing a little lightning into your life. Strength of their atomic bombs. I totally messed up, but it's okay because it's funny. Matrix. The truth is out there. Now, before we get too crazy here, just a second, guys. My girlfriend's on the phone. Hello?
Are you recording my dad?
Yeah, this is totally going in the bloopers.